Morning, everyone. Before Mass starts this morning, we'll sing through hymn number 325. So please feel free to join in as we prepare for Mass number 325.
Thank you. Jesus Christ is Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Good morning and a very, very warm welcome to Mass. And Abigail, where are you? Now you're going to take this, you're going to hold it high. Are you? Well done. Right, kids, follow Abigail for children's liturgy. Today's reading takes us back to that Sunday after the resurrection, or the evening of the resurrection, and it's Luke's gospel. We've just, before this passage, we've had Jesus meeting the disciples on the road to Emmaus, and now we're back with the group of disciples, and it's been reported to, and Jesus appears amongst them and gives them one of the great commissions to go out and to witness to the resurrection. And then in the Acts of the Apostles, which is also written by St. Luke, we have Peter out there proclaiming the gospel, proclaiming the core truth of Jesus' death and resurrection. It's one mystery, not two. Jesus' death leads to his resurrection. The resurrection is the fruit of Good Friday. So let's bring ourselves to the foot of the cross, but in the light of the resurrection, seeking the Lord's mercy, as we say, I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned, in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people.
Let us pray. May your people exult forever, O God, in renewed youthfulness of spirit, so that rejoicing now in the restored glory of our adoption, we may look forward in confident hope to the rejoicing of the day of resurrection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter said to the people, "You are Israelites, and it is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our ancestors, who has glorified his servant Jesus, the same Jesus you handed over and then disowned in the presence of Pilate, after Pilate had decided to release him. It was you who accused the Holy One, the Just One, you who demanded the reprieve of a murderer while you killed the Prince of Life. God, however, raised him from the dead, and to that fact we are the witnesses. Now I know, brothers, that neither you nor your leaders had any idea what you were really doing. This was the way God carried out what he had foretold, when he said through all his prophets that his Christ would suffer. Now you must repent and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lift up the light of your face on us, O Lord.
Lift up the light of your face in us.
When I call, answer me, O God of justice. From anguish you released me. Have mercy and hear me.
Lift up the light of your face.
It is the Lord who grants favors to those whom he loves. The Lord hears me whenever I call him.
Lift up the light of your face in us.
What can bring us happiness, many say. Lift up the light of your face in us, O Lord.
Lift up the light of your face, O Lord.
I will lie down in peace and sleep comes at once, for you alone, Lord, make me dwell in safety.
Lift up the light of your face, O Lord.
A reading from the first letter of St. John. I am writing this, my children, to stop you sinning. But if anyone should sin, we have our advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, who is just. He is the sacrifice that takes our sins away, and not only ours, but the whole world's. We can be sure that we know God only by keeping his commandments. Anyone who says, "I know him," and does not keep his commandments is a liar, refusing to admit the truth. But when anyone does obey what he has said, God's love comes to perfection in him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
Lord Jesus, explain the scriptures to us. Make our hearts burn within us as you talk to us.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
The disciples told a story of what happened on the road and how they'd recognized Jesus at the breaking of bread. They were still talking about this when Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." In a state of alarm and fright, they thought they were seeing a ghost, but he said, "Why are you so agitated? And why are these doubts rising in your hearts? Look at my hands and feet. Yes, it is I, indeed. Touch me and see for yourself. A ghost has no flesh and bones, as you can see I have. And as he said this, he showed them his hands and feet. Their joy was great that they could not believe it. And they stood dumbfounded, so he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" And they offered him a piece of grilled fish, which he took and ate before their eyes. Then he told them, "This is what I meant when I said, while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms has to be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "So you see how it is written that the Christ would suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that in his name repentance for the forgiveness of sins would be preached to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses to this." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Try and put these readings in a little bit of chronological order, remembering that the Gospel of Luke and the Acts of the Apostles are written by the same person, traditionally known as Luke, the divine physician, one of the followers of St. Paul. Then the Gospel then is written and precedes the Acts of the Apostles. Now, it's all about Jesus. The Gospel today is all about that encounter with Jesus after his resurrection and in establishing that he's flesh and blood, that he's not a ghost. It's not just a spiritual resurrection, but there's a material part to it. And then that whole idea then that the church at this point in Luke's Gospel is given a mission, the mission to go and proclaim the Gospel, beginning in Jerusalem. And then we jump a few weeks, and we're now in Jerusalem just after the day of Pentecost, and Peter is out proclaiming the Gospel, proclaiming a frightening Gospel if you are the preacher, because you've got to go and stand in the streets of Jerusalem and say, "You've killed your Messiah. God sent Jesus into the world as our Lord and Messiah, and you killed him." And of course, Christians have heard that for very many centuries, and it led to enormous persecution because they heard that without hearing the next bit, which is, "But you didn't know what you were doing, and it was all God's plan anyway." That God planned that Jesus, his son, would come into the world, and that he would suffer and die. And, says Jesus, if you look back through the prophets, you'll find that story. Now, it's more a descant. It's not really the core story of the Old Testament, but the idea of a Messiah who will come and suffer for the sins of his people, suffer for the sins of the world. So together, then, you've got this idea of Jesus' death, witnessing to the resurrection, and then proclaiming that witness to the world. Now, the resurrection's the key. Lots of prophets died in suffering, and many people in Jesus' time and after died suffering for the truth. So the resurrection is the key. It's the resurrection that needs to be lived, and it's the resurrection that needs to be witnessed to. So, that early part of the proclamation of the core gospel, Jesus died, but more importantly, he's risen. But once you say he's risen, then you've got to ask, why did he die? Now, that's picked up in various parts of the New Testament, of course, but today it's picked up in John's letter. Again, probably written after the Gospel of Luke and the Acts of the Apostles. We don't completely know. But again, it's that interpretation that if Jesus died and rose again, and if God purposed his death, then it has to have meaning. There has to be a reason to it. And so again, as I said before, they go back to the temple and the sacrifices in the temple and the sacrifices of sin in the temple that re-establish relationship between God and humanity, or between God and the individual person, or between God and the nation. So, St. John says, here we are, the ultimate and final sacrifice. Jesus dies for the sins, not just of the individual person, not just of the Jewish nation, but of the whole world, that every single person may be and can be included in that sacrificial death. You and I need to re-encounter it. The church encourages, of course, to re-encounter it every Sunday. That's what the Eucharist is all about, meeting and encountering the death and the resurrection of Jesus, and then receiving his resurrection life into ourselves in order to be able to have the energy, the spiritual energy, to live out. But that's what we've got to do. And Easter time is the best time. And again, remember, on Easter Sunday, we remake our commitment, we make our baptismal commitment to follow the Lord and be his witnesses. Now, we're not very good at that bit. I always try to think, for about 1700 years, it was normative. Your children got baptized, your children got whatever happened confirmed in some way, received the Eucharist, and then their children got baptized and got confirmed in some way and received the Eucharist, and then their children, and so on and so forth. It worked. Really, till after the Second World War, that simple system of passing on the faith and passing on the sacraments worked. Now, I don't know whether it was the trauma of the First World War followed by the trauma of the Second World War, but in the Western world, a dislocation gets in. It no longer works. That simple passing on no longer works. And in a few weeks' time, we will have kids here, as we've had kids here every year since I came and before. And we know that we'll get them here, and then they'll disappear again, and then we'll get the next group in. But fundamentally, it no longer works. We've sort of lost the ability to evangelize. We've maybe done a bit of teaching, but we've not evangelized. And so there's no point in keeping to flogging a dead horse. You have to go back to earlier experiences of faith, when the truth had to be proclaimed, had to be witnessed to, had to be experienced, and then lived for this to happen again. And so we have to go back to that original proclamation and say, how do we proclaim the gospel? How do we live it? How do we share it? How do we let men and women come into an encounter with Jesus crucified and risen? So we have to become much more evangelical than we've needed to be. Well, maybe not. That's not true. Maybe in Africa and various parts of the developing world, we're still evangelical. But here in the West, we're a bit flabby and a bit just relying on things just happening the way they always happened. We can't do that anymore. We can't. So we have to relearn how to live the gospel and proclaim the gospel. Now, the earliest way is then knowing the core truths of the faith. And you'll see once more, we've got this Alpha course going, and it's about knowing the very core truths. It's knowing that very beginnings of the gospel, who Jesus is, what he did, what his death meant, how do you receive it, all of those things. And just as importantly, how do you receive the Holy Spirit in a more proactive way than perhaps just simply confirmation. And then there's a more Catholic way, and we lost it. Rather strangely, we lost it at the Second Vatican Council. Exposition and benediction of the Blessed Sacrament was a way really up into the 1960s that the church evangelized. You'll listen to stories of convert accounts in the 1950s. It often happened when they went to benediction because it was not a service that said you can come this far and no further. It was just you were there, you were in silence, Jesus was there and present, and therefore Jesus himself was able to reach out through the power of the Holy Spirit. So the old Catholic way in the 1950s really was benediction. Maybe not in a place like Musselburgh, where largely people were coming anyway, but the cities, the university towns, benediction was a great place. It was a place where anyone could come to, and the Lord was there for them. So maybe we need to do both, that we don't just talk of the Alpha course in that very evangelical way of proclaiming the gospel, but that we revisit how we do a regular exposition of the Blessed Sacrament and regular benediction, so that that means of Jesus himself simply being there and present, reaching out into our hearts and our lives, and a place that we can bring people to where we know that in the end there'll be no barrier, it's just there for them. So we have to again realize how that we're going to relive the gospel, proclaim the gospel, but not do it in an evangelical way that's different from who we are. We need to be able to do it in a Catholic way as well. So on this day, we're remembering Christ crucified and Christ risen. We're remembering it's our task to proclaim the gospel, and we're to remember that Jesus died for our sins as a sacrifice. Our task is to bring people into that relationship with Christ. So let's stand and affirm our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. My sisters and brothers, Jesus continues to call us to repentance so that God's love can come to perfection in us.
We pray for the Pope's intentions for April, for all women, that their dignity may be respected and their lives be free of all discrimination. Christ, hear us.
Christ, graciously hear us.
We pray for the release of all the Israeli hostages and of the Palestinians held in prison without being charged of any crime. Christ, hear us.
Christ, graciously hear us.
We pray for an end to all wars, violence, and terrorism in the Holy Land, Ukraine, Haiti, Myanmar, Nigeria, Yemen, and South Sudan. Christ, hear us.
Christ, graciously hear us.
We pray for each other, that like the disciples, with our minds opened and graced with forgiveness, we can be witnesses to the risen Christ in the daily circumstances of our lives. Christ, hear us.
Christ, graciously hear us.
We pray for our faithful departed, for Davy Hall, who died recently, and for Ina Wilson, Bill Houston, Donato Crolla, John Dixon, Teresa Carpath, Helen Gibbs, Rosemary Darnell, Ina Pride, and Alex Stewart, whose anniversaries fall this week. May they rest in peace. Christ, hear us.
Christ, graciously hear us. Silence, we bring our own prayers before the Lord. I offer the sacrifice of this Mass in particular for the repose of the soul of Monica Spence, whose anniversary falls at this time. Can I also ask for your prayers for Father Andy Monaghan, who died recently and whose funeral is tomorrow morning. And we commend Monica and all whom we love to the prayers of Mary, the Mother of Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Lord Jesus, empower us to witness to the Father's love by the way in which we live in the world, for you live and reign forever and ever. Pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Receive, O Lord, we pray, these offerings of your exultant Church, and as you have given her cause for such great gladness, grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation at all times, to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. Through him the children of light rise to eternal life, and the halls of the heavenly kingdom are thrown open to the faithful. For his death is our ransom from death, and in his rising the life of all has risen. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic host sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which shall be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your Church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Leo our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, our spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. the Saviour's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Look with kindness upon your people, O Lord, and grant, we pray, that those you are pleased to renew by eternal mysteries may attain in their flesh the incorruptible glory of the resurrection, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. You'll see senior parishioners' afternoon tea. There are sheets at the back and there are invitations. Please take them away. If you know of anyone who wants to come along, bring friends as well. It's not just for parishioners. Let's put it as parishioners and friends. And that's Thursday the 23rd of May at 3 p.m. You'll see the Alpha course is advertised. There are some sheets at the back of the church, and further information will be available. I would encourage as many of you, I think that this might be for you, to undertake the Alpha course. Next Sunday is Good Shepherd Sunday, World Day of Prayer for Vocations. At the same time, there'll be a special collection taken for seminarian training. We have, I think, still 4 seminarians in Rome. We're still looking for church gardening volunteers. Every Wednesday's wet, and I've seen people out in other times. It's a miserable, miserable time, but if you can, if you have a little time on Wednesday morning when it's dry, we'll be grateful. But indoor flower work, you could do a bit of flower arranging. It doesn't have to be ladies, it can be gentlemen as well. Even altar servers, if you're any good with flowers. Anyway, we need some flower arranging just to see us through now, through the summer months. Again, if you think you can give an hour to this once a week, that would be really very helpful. I think that's everything just now, other than, of course, we're not that far away from confirmations. I shall go into the school this week to see Primary 7, and that's on Tuesday the 30th, but really good to have Primary 7 here next week and the week after that, just to have a chat with them. So confirmations, and remember it's in Trinend at 7 p.m. Again, if you can come along and support our young people, that would be very good indeed. I think that's everything. Can I ask you to stand, please, and let's bow our heads and pray for God's blessing. Oh, no, there's one thing. Tony Dolan is Elvis's brother. And Tony celebrated his 80th birthday this last few days. So I think we should embarrass him, if it's at all possible to embarrass him, by singing, "Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Elvis. Happy birthday to you." And of course, very different note, of course, Davy Hall's funeral is at 9:30 on Friday. He'll be received into the church at 4 o'clock the night before. Please continue to pray for him and his family. So now you can bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May God, who by the resurrection of his only begotten Son was pleased to confer on you the gift of redemption and of adoption, give you gladness by his blessing. Amen. May he, by whose redeeming work you have received the gift of everlasting freedom, make you heirs to an eternal inheritance. Amen. And may you, who have already risen with Christ in baptism through faith, by living in a right manner on the earth, be united with him in the homeland of heaven. Amen. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever. Amen. Thanks be to God.
The Lord is alive, alleluia.